Many people may remember the terror caused by ISIS nearly a decade ago. In 2004, a year after the United States invaded Iraq, the Islamic extremist leader Abu Musab al-Zarqawi, a member of Al-Qaeda, founded an Iraqi branch of the terrorist organization in order to fight against the American military. Eventually, there were ideological differences between al-Zarqawi and Osama bin Laden, the founder and head of Al-Qaeda, and eventually al-Zarqawi's organization split off from Al-Qaeda. Under the leadership of its second leader, Abu Ayyub al-Masri, who came to power within ISIS after the death of al-Zarqawi in 2006, the organization changed its name to the Islamic State of Iraq. Sometimes referred to as the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, or ISIS for short, or the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, or ISIL. The organization's aim was to establish an Islamic caliphate based primarily in Iraq and Syria that would become the center for a new Islamic world order. A caliphate, as you may know, is a territory ruled by a caliph. A caliph being, in the Islamic religion, the highest civil and religious authority who is seen as a successor to the Prophet Muhammad, the founder of Islam. Starting in 2014, ISIS began a series of terrorist attacks and military campaigns in Iraq in an attempt to undermine the newly established post-Saddam Iraqi government. Shortly thereafter, with the start of the Syrian civil war, many ISIS members began to fight on behalf of the rebel forces. With a desire to overthrow Syrian President Bashar al-Assad and hopefully establish an Islamic fundamentalist government in that region. Over the course of the ensuing years, ISIS established branches throughout the Middle East. One thing they were known for was their brutal persecution of non-Muslims, including and especially Christians. Christians and other non-Muslim groups were forced to pay a special tax in order to live in territories conquered by ISIS, and were often killed or sent into exile if they refused. Many churches and monasteries were destroyed, and acts of violence against Christians were common. This, in spite of the fact that the Middle East is the home of some of the oldest Christian communities in the world. One of the most brutal examples of this was a video released on February 15, 2015, showing ISIS agents from the Libyan branch of the terrorist organization parading a group of 21 captives along the coast just outside of Wilayat Tarablus, formerly known as Tripoli, in northwestern Libya. The captives were a group of Christians who were members of the Coptic Orthodox Church in Egypt, who had been kidnapped by ISIS agents between December of 2014 and January of 2015. The Christians had been staying in the town of Sirte in eastern Libya, one of the regions with a strong ISIS presence, and were kidnapped during an ISIS invasion of that town that took place during this period. All of the captives were beheaded, with the whole endeavor being recorded and released to the media. When the Egyptian government proved the authenticity of the video, Egyptian President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi called for a meeting of Egyptian security officials and set aside a 7-day period of mourning in honor of the victims of this brutality. Within less than a week after their martyrdom, Pope Tawadros II, the head of the Coptic Orthodox Church, declared these men to be saints and martyrs to be honored by the Church. Now, many Catholics should, and rightfully so, feel bad for these men who died a brutal and unjust death, and should be inspired by their bravery in not giving up their faith in Jesus or their Christian identity. Yet, the fact still remains. These men were not Catholic, and although most likely validly baptized and sincerely believing in Jesus, were members of an organization, the Coptic Orthodox Church, that is not currently in communion with the Roman Catholic Church, which we as Catholics believe to be the one true church. These men, at the end of the day, for all of their bravery, were not members of the one true church founded by Jesus Christ. Simply being a non-Catholic or a non-Christian does not mean that you cannot obtain a high level of virtue, and simply being a member of a non-Catholic branch of Christianity does not mean that it is impossible for you to have a deep and sincere faith in Jesus. Yet, the Catholic Church wouldn't declare such a person to be a saint, right? I mean, the notion of a non-Catholic being honored as a saint in the Catholic Church, that sounds a bit odd, doesn't it? Yet, this is exactly what happened. On Thursday, May 11th of this year, Pope Tawadros visited Pope Francis in the Vatican, and during the meeting, the Pope declared that the Catholic Church would officially recognize the 21 Coptic martyrs as saints. Pope Tawadros even gifted Pope Francis with a relic of the martyrs. This seems like an interesting scenario. There are literally no saints currently honored by the Catholic Church who aren't Catholic. Is it even possible for the Catholic Church to canonize such a saint? Can a non-Catholic be considered a saint within the Catholic Church? Many say no. And the reason for this is because such an action would violate one of the core elements of Catholic theology, namely the doctrine of extra ecclesiam nulla salus, Latin for outside of the church there is no salvation. And the church has applied this even to martyrs or members of the faithful who die outside of full communion with the church. One medieval magisterial document that's often cited, Cantate Dominum, was published by the Council of Florence in 1442 and was officially approved by Pope Eugene IV. In one section it says, and I quote, "The Church firmly believes, confesses, and preaches that no one outside of the Catholic Church, not only pagans, but neither Jews nor heretics nor schismatics, can become partakers of eternal life, but will go into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels," cross-reference Matthew chapter 25, verse 41, "unless by the end of their life they be united to the church, so that the unity of the ecclesiastical body is so strong that only those who remain in it may receive the sacraments of the church unto salvation, and perform fasting, almsgiving, and other pious services so as to produce eternal rewards, and that no one, no matter how great his alms, even if he should spill his blood in the name of Christ, unless he remain united to the Catholic Church," unquote. It seems pretty clear-cut here that no matter how great one's faith is, unless one is united to the Church and believes all that it says, they cannot be saved, even if they should shed their blood in the name of Christ and for the cause of the gospel, i.e. die a martyr. If they do so outside of the church, they cannot be saved. Seems pretty clear-cut, right? Yet this statement takes place within the larger context of an affirmation of the general Christian view on salvation. Like literally, that's what you see in most of the document up until this quote. Thus, we can interpret this text not simply as an affirmation of extra ecclesiam nulla salus, but also more specifically as implying a larger anti-Pelagian view. One cannot be saved apart from what Christ did for us in becoming human, dying on the cross, and rising from the dead, the effects of which are communicated to us through the church, that is, through the preaching of the gospel and the administering of the sacraments. Hence the importance of union with the church. The core of what the church was trying to say at Florence, or rather what it was fighting against, can be seen in the ecumenically oriented quasi-universalism of the modern period. In funeral sermons, we say about anyone shy of complete degenerates, "Yeah, he's probably in a better place now." Heaven is seen as the inevitable conclusion of the life of anyone in any religion who has even the slightest bit of holiness or virtue. Yet, it is technically not impossible for non-Christians to be saved. There are two types of ignorance: vincible ignorance and invincible ignorance. Vincible ignorance, also known as willful ignorance, refers to when a person had the means to discern the truth but chose not to, or had some inkling that Christianity, or Catholic Christianity in specific, was true but suppressed it due to laziness or fear or some other reason. Anyone who rejects the one true faith out of either vincible ignorance or out of malice, that is to say, they acknowledge that Christianity was true but rejected it anyway, cannot be saved because they are willingly rejecting the way to salvation. Yet invincible ignorance refers to ignorance of the truth caused by factors beyond one's control. One who lived in an isolated area, for example, and was never exposed to the gospel, still has a possibility of salvation. Such people, if they are acting in good faith, that is, if they are in a frame of mind where they would have accepted the truth had they been exposed to it, a frame of mind where they have an authentic, unbiased desire to know the truth, whatever it may be, don't have salvation completely cut off from them. As Pope Pius IX teaches in his encyclical Singulari Quidem, paragraphs 4 and 7, quote, "You see, dearly beloved sons and venerable brethren, how much vigilance is needed to keep the disease of this terrible evil from infecting and killing your flocks. Do not cease to diligently defend your people against these pernicious errors. Saturate them with the doctrine of Catholic truth more accurately each day. Teach them that just as there is only one God, one Christ, one Holy Spirit, so too there is only one truth which is divinely revealed. There is only one divine faith which is the beginning of salvation for mankind and the basis of all justification, the faith by which the just person lives and without which it is impossible to please God and come to the community of his children. There is only one true holy Catholic Church, which is the Apostolic Roman Church. There is only one see founded in Peter by the word of the Lord, outside of which we cannot find either true faith or eternal salvation. He who does not have the Church for a mother cannot have God for a father, and whoever abandons the see of Peter on which the Church is established trusts falsely that he is in the Church. Thus, there can be no greater crime, no more hideous stain, than to stand up against Christ, than to divide the Church engendered and purchased by his blood, than to forget the evangelical love and to combat with the furor of hostile discord the harmony of the people of God. The Church clearly declares that the only hope of salvation for mankind is placed in the Christian faith, which teaches the truth, scatters the darkness of ignorance by the splendor of its light, and walks through love. This hope of salvation is placed in the Catholic Church, which, in preserving the true worship, is the solid home of this faith and the temple of God. Outside of the Church, no one can hope for life or salvation unless he is excused through ignorance beyond his control." Unquote. The Second Vatican Council teaches similarly in the document Lumen Gentium. Quote, "This sacred council wishes to turn its attention firstly to the Catholic faithful. Basing itself upon sacred scripture and sacred tradition, it teaches that the Church, now sojourning on earth as an exile, is necessary for salvation. Christ, present to us in his body, which is the Church, is the one mediator and the unique way of salvation. In explicit terms, he himself affirms the necessity of faith and baptism, and thereby affirms also the necessity of the Church. For through baptism, as through a door, men enter into the Church. Whosoever, therefore, knowing that the Catholic Church was made necessary by Christ, would refuse to enter or to remain in it, could not be saved. Nor is God far distant from those who, in shadows and images, seek the unknown God. For it is he who gives to all men life and breath and all things, and as Savior wills that all men be saved. Those also can attain to salvation who, through no fault of their own, do not know the gospel of Christ or his church, yet sincerely seek God, and, moved by grace, strive by their deeds to do his will as it is known to them through the dictates of conscience." Unquote. Cross-reference Lumen Gentium, paragraphs 14 and 16. This is rooted in a broader principle within Catholic moral theology that states that ignorance can reduce culpability, as many of even the greatest saints have taught. So, simply being a non-Catholic or a non-Christian does not preclude you from salvation. Yet, if a non-Catholic or a non-Christian is saved, it is in spite of the fact that they are a non-Catholic or a non-Christian. Outside of union with God and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit brought about by the grace of baptism, one cannot obtain supernatural or Christian virtue, including and especially the gifts of faith, hope, and charity, whereby one merits salvation, insofar as one is not united to Christ, and therefore is outside of the church, there is some obstacle to their salvation. Now, the power of Christ to save is not limited by the church or the sacraments, though these are the primary means in which and through which he works, and thus Christ can apply the effects of his saving mission to a non-Christian or a non-Catholic who has a sincere desire to know the truth, and thus would have become a Christian had they been given the opportunity, but failed due to situations beyond their control. But a Christian or a Catholic has been given access to the means of salvation, whereas someone outside of the church has not. Therefore, it is not because of anything in these false religions, but rather in spite of these obstacles that a non-Catholic or a non-Christian is saved. Yet, in the situation that we actually found ourselves in, with Pope Francis canonizing a group of Coptic martyrs, things get a little bit more complicated. Pope Francis did not declare as a saint one who is outside of the church in an absolute sense. One who is outside of the church in an absolute sense would be someone like a Jew, a Muslim, an atheist, or a pagan. These are people who don't believe in Jesus, who have never been baptized, who have never received sanctifying grace and therefore have never been justified, and therefore are outside of the church. Rather, what happened was Pope Francis canonized a group of men who belonged to a non-Catholic form of Christianity. Such men were, in all likelihood, validly baptized. The only reason why I say in all likelihood is because Coptic Orthodox baptisms are sacramentally and canonically valid. They're illicit because they're performed outside of the one true church, but they're still valid. Yet, I don't know these specific individual men. You see, just because most Coptic Orthodox baptisms are valid doesn't mean each individual Coptic Orthodox Christian or Coptic Orthodox clergy performs baptism in a sacramentally valid manner. We know, for example, that not even every Catholic priest performs baptism in a valid manner. Sad, but true. Yet, these people did believe in Jesus, they did identify as Christians, and in all likelihood, they did have a valid baptism, and therefore, by virtue of their baptism, were a part of the church. Yet, due to their affiliation with an organization not currently in communion with the one true church, they were not perfectly united to or in full communion with the church. They were therefore imperfectly united to the church. Can't such an individual ever be declared a saint by the Catholic Church? Let me explain. Everyone tends to simplify baptism simply as initiation into the church. It is actually something much broader. The concept of initiation is used throughout the church's treatment of baptism, but it isn't merely initiation into an institution. For example, the Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraph 1248, describes the effect of baptism as one being, quote, initiated into the mystery of salvation and the practice of the evangelical virtues, unquote. That is, in baptism, the effects of Jesus' death and resurrection are applied to us, and the effect of this is that we are given the ability to live out the virtues associated with the way of life spelled out in the Gospels. We are therefore, as a result of this, made partakers of God's larger plan of salvation. Baptism thus serves as the means in which and through which we receive eternal life and are born again. As paragraphs 1255, 1257, 1263, and 1270 of the Catechism say, basing themselves on such biblical texts as John chapter 3, verse 3, John chapter 3, verse 5, and Romans chapter 6, verses 3 through 4. Baptism, therefore, unites us to Christ. As St. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27, the church is the body of Christ, and we, by grace, are members of it. Yet the Catechism, paragraph 1267, says that we are made members of the body of Christ through baptism, since it is in baptism that we first receive sanctifying grace and are therefore first united to Christ. Yet, on the other hand, insofar as the basis of unity in the church is our common relationship with Christ, and insofar as we can say that the church is a community or institution, founded on the communion of believers, and insofar as a result of this, there is a hierarchical or institutional element to the church, baptism does have the effect of initiating us into the church. As the Code of Canon Law, Canon 849, says, quote, through baptism, men and women are freed from sin, and are reborn as children of God, and, configured to Christ, as by an indelible character, are incorporated into the church, unquote. Now, there's something I want to focus in on here. The Code of Canon Law says that we are configured to Christ, quote, by an indelible character, unquote. What this means is that the spiritual effects of baptism upon the soul are permanent. As the Catechism, paragraph 1272 says, quote, baptism seals the Christian with the indelible spiritual mark or character of his belonging to Christ. No sin can erase this mark, even if sin prevents baptism from bearing the fruits of salvation. Given once and for all, baptism cannot be repeated, unquote. The effects of baptism upon the soul are permanent and irreversible. No sin can undo what baptism brings about in the soul, though certain sins or other circumstances, even if they don't technically constitute or lead to sin, can prevent the effects of baptism from fully playing out in the life of the believer. Thus, a person once baptized can never be technically outside of the church, not even in the case of excommunication. A lot of people think that excommunication means being kicked out of the church, but as I said before, a baptized person can never be fully removed from the church. And it's easy to misinterpret excommunication as being kicked out of the church, because a lot of saints and theologians in the church speak about it in a way that would imply that. For example, in the supplementum of the Summa Theologica, question 21, article 1, it's written, quote, by baptism, he, the one being baptized, is admitted into two things, namely, the body of the faithful and the participation in the sacraments, unquote. Yet, through excommunication, one is, quote, deprived of both, unquote. The notion of being deprived of membership in the body of the faithful can easily be misinterpreted as meaning that we are no longer considered a part of the church, we are no longer Catholic. But the real meaning of this makes more sense when we look at it in light of the official, magisterial, and canonical definitions surrounding excommunication. The Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraph 1463, defines excommunication as, quote, the most severe ecclesiastical penalty which impedes the reception of the sacraments and the exercise of certain ecclesiastical acts, unquote. In the 1917 edition of the Code of Canon Law, it defined excommunication as, quote, a censor by which one is excluded from the communion of the faithful, unquote. To not be in communion with the Church means that you are no longer considered on good terms with the Church, and as such, you cannot participate fully in the life of the Church. As the current edition of the Code of Canon Law says, an excommunicated person cannot receive or administer the sacraments except in the case of emergency. They cannot acquire any office, dignity, or function in the Church, and if they are already in some position of authority in the Church, they end up losing all or part of their authority or the rights attached to their office. They cannot lead any religious service in the Church, except in the case of emergency. All of this is repeated in the 1917 edition of the Code of Canon Law. The 1917 edition of the Code of Canon Law, Canon 1240, also adds to this that any excommunicated person could be denied a Christian burial. The current edition of the Code of Canon Law, more specifically Canon 1184, only explicitly mentions heretics, schismatics, and apostates, presumably those who have been declared as such by the Church in a public manner and therefore excommunicated, as well as quote-unquote other manifest sinners who cannot be granted ecclesiastical funerals without public scandal of the faithful, unquote, which could include, but is not limited to, those who have been excommunicated. But it doesn't actually say that all excommunicates are to be denied a Christian burial. Bishop Francis Edward Highland, a priest and scholar of theology, who later went on to serve as the bishop of the Diocese of Atlanta from the late 1940s through the early 1960s, wrote his PhD dissertation on the history and theology behind excommunication. He describes excommunication as, quote, a censor, that is, a penalty by which a baptized person, delinquent and contumacious, is deprived of some spiritual goods, or goods annexed to spiritual things, until he ceases to be contumacious and is absolved, unquote. He goes on to say, quote, a censor deprives one of some spiritual goods or goods annexed to spiritual matters. There are some spiritual goods which the Church cannot deprive the faithful of. For example, divine grace, internal virtue, the power of orders, etc. A censor can only deprive one of those spiritual goods which are within the power of the Church. For example, the administration and reception of the sacraments, indulgences, jurisdiction, ecclesiastical burial, etc., and also of temporal goods, which have some relation to spiritual matters, for example, the emoluments of a benefice, the administration of ecclesiastical goods, etc., unquote. Thus, the conclusion of all of this is that excommunication is a punishment of certain sins that are seen as obstacles to one properly functioning or participating in the life of the Church, and in order to prompt that person to conversion, it prevents them from being able to fully participate in the life of the Church or receive certain spiritual or material benefits associated with the Church's ministry. Yet, if baptism initiates you into the Church, and the effects of baptism are irreversible, excommunication, while limiting your ability to participate in the Church, does not kick you out of the Church. The same could be said about heretics, schismatics, and apostates. The Code of Canon Law, paragraph 751, defines these three sins as follows, quote, heresy is the obstinate denial or obstinate doubt after the reception of baptism of some truth which is to be believed by divine and Catholic faith. Apostasy is the total repudiation of the Christian faith. Schism is the refusal of submission to the Supreme Pontiff or of communion with the members of the Church subject to him, unquote. Now, heretics, apostates, and schismatics are subject to excommunication. Yet, even in instances where heretics, schismatics, or apostates have not been explicitly or publicly subject to excommunication, one can technically only be a heretic, schismatic, or apostate only after they have been baptized, and thus misinterpreting or denying or doubting some part of the faith, which is heresy, rejecting the faith after one has initially accepted it, which is apostasy, and refusing to submit to the authority of the church, which is schism, are different from being an infidel, since an infidel is one who has not accepted the faith and has not been baptized. Whereas heresy, schism, and apostasy are sins that get in the way of us fully living out the faith or living out one's baptismal vows or the effects of one's baptism, and therefore serve as obstacles to life in the church. Yet, not even these sins technically place one outside of the church, since, as the Catechism says, quote, no one can erase this mark, unquote, that is, the mark of baptism. Thus, not even being a heretic, schismatic, or apostate, or being subject to excommunication can place one outside of the church, in the strict sense of the term, outside the church. At least not once they've been validly baptized. This is the reason why schismatics, heretics, apostates, and those subject to excommunication need their sins absolved, but don't need to be rebaptized. A person baptized outside of the strict institutional limits of the Catholic Church is still validly baptized, assuming that the baptism had valid matter, form, and intention. Thus, the Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraph 1256, says, quote, the ordinary ministers of baptism are the bishop and priest, and, in the Latin Church, also the deacon. In case of necessity, anyone, even a non-baptized person, with the required intention, can baptize by using the Trinitarian baptismal formula. The intention required is to will to do what the Church does when she baptizes, unquote. Similarly, if a convert to the Catholic faith was not baptized, they must be baptized in order to become a Catholic. Further, if there is doubt as to whether or not a person was validly baptized or baptized at all, but no direct evidence that the baptism was invalid, or that they weren't baptized, a person would have to undergo what is known as a conditional baptism, which is essentially a normal baptism, but you add to the baptismal formula the words, if you are not already baptized, then... And then you go on to say, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. But that's the thing. People baptized outside of the Catholic Church, where there is some doubt as to whether or not they were validly baptized, or baptized at all, would have to undergo a conditional baptism. And people baptized in non-Catholic churches are not expected to undergo conditional baptism. Thus, the Code of Canon Law, Canon 869, Section 2, says, quote, those baptized in a non-Catholic ecclesial community must not be baptized conditionally unless, after an examination of the matter and form of the words used in the conferral of baptism, and a consideration of the intention of the baptized adult and minister of the baptism, a serious reason exists to doubt the validity of the baptism. Unquote. Basically, so long as a baptism is performed with valid matter, form, and intention, anyone, even a non-Catholic or a non-Christian, can baptize. And most non-Catholic branches of Christianity have what the Catholic Church would consider to be a valid baptism. Together with all of this, there is another truth that we need to take into consideration, namely that Jesus Christ only established one church. There are no other churches besides the one true church founded by Jesus Christ. There are institutions that claim to be churches, but part of what makes a church, is the fact that it was founded by Jesus Christ. If a group, organization, or institution breaks away from the church, it is outside of the one true church. The church is, essentially, the sheepfold of Christ. And yet no group, movement, or organization can be outside of the flock and yet still claim to be an extension of it. Thus, whenever one is baptized, they are, whether they know it or not, initiated into the Catholic Church. Because of these two facts, non-Catholic Christians do not need to be rebaptized when converting to Catholicism. This is the reason why Christ said in John chapter 10 verse 16, quote, "I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. These also I must lead, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock, one shepherd," unquote. Baptized individuals, by virtue of their baptism, belong to Christ, and therefore are members of his church, the Catholic Church. But obstacles exist on an institutional level to them being in full communion with the church. Therefore, when you look at one of Vatican II's documents, more specifically its document on ecumenism, titled Unitatis Redintegratio, paragraph 3, it says, quote, "For men who believe in Christ and have been truly baptized are in communion with the Catholic Church, even though this communion is imperfect. The differences that exist in varying degrees between them and the Catholic Church, whether in doctrine and sometimes in discipline, or concerning the structure of the Church, do indeed create many obstacles, sometimes serious ones, to full ecclesiastical communion. The ecumenical movement is striving to overcome these obstacles, but even in spite of them, it remains true that all who have been justified by faith in baptism are members of Christ's body and have a right to be called Christian, and so are correctly accepted as brothers by the children of the Catholic Church," unquote. As a result, we are not saying that such a person as the Coptic martyrs would be in heaven because they are virtuous enough or holy enough. Rather, they have been given, by their baptism, the spiritual gifts necessary to live a life of holiness and virtue, manifested to a degree so as to be willing to die for the faith, or, put another way, to desire death over giving up loyalty to Christ. And again, this is because they, unlike a Jew, or a Muslim, or a pagan, or an atheist, received the grace of baptism. Further, because of their baptism, there is some sense in which we can say that they are truly a part of the church. Their communion with the church is not perfect because the religious organization with which they associate is not in perfect or full communion with the one true church founded by Jesus Christ. Their schism serves as an obstacle to true union with the church, but the valid baptism and sincere faith in Jesus means that they are truly Christians and, to a degree, members of the one true church. I would thus like to conclude by asking two questions. One, is it, based on everything I said above, possible for the Catholic Church to beatify as saints those outside of the church? And two, was it prudent? Concerning the first question, I am still somewhat torn, but based on everything that was said above, the reality of invincible ignorance, the indelible mark of baptism, the notion that one is a member of the church simply by virtue of their act of freely choosing to be baptized, regardless of whether or not they specifically intended on being Catholic, the sincerity of their faith in Jesus. Based on all of this, I would say that it is, in a technical, canonical sense, not impossible. Yet, was it prudent? Well, there are two ways of looking at this. From an ecumenical perspective, and from a practical, spiritual perspective. It could be argued, and in fact I have seen it argued by several respectable online Catholic commentators, that Pope Francis's act of canonizing the Coptic martyrs represented a major step in the right direction in ecumenical relations. It represented a major step forward in restoring relations between the Catholic Church and the Coptic Orthodox Church. And I don't think that that's an unreasonable point. Yet, most Catholics are not all that familiar with the nuances and intricacies of canon law and sacramental theology that I just described. most saints tend to either be members of the church or biblical figures. And, again, those two things aren't necessarily mutually exclusive, because the Catholic Church claims to be the one true church founded by Jesus Christ, and if this claim is true, that means all of the Christian figures in the New Testament were actually Catholics. And since the religion of ancient Israel was a prophecy or a foreshadowing of the Catholic Church, then that means the Old Testament figures were members of the same religion as the New Testament and the post-biblical figures, but just the same religion at different points in its revelation. But because this is the case, the notion of canonizing a saint who wasn't fully in communion with the Catholic Church may lead to the false impression that union with the Church is absolutely unimportant for salvation or growth in holiness. What I think we can all agree upon is that, even if you think it was not necessarily the right decision to canonize these saints, these men are the victims of unjust persecution and bigotry against Christians, and as a result deserve our prayers and sympathy. Secondly, their death should bring attention to the reality of the plight that many Middle Eastern Christians go through just to preserve their heritage. Christianity originated in the Middle East, and some of the oldest Christian communities exist in the Middle East and in the territories immediately surrounding it. I would even go as far as saying that Middle Eastern Christians have a moral obligation to preserve and defend their communities, and we, as people living outside of the Middle East, have a moral and spiritual obligation to help them in this process. For if Middle Eastern Christianity, whether in its Catholic or non-Catholic forms, dies out, we have lost a major part of our heritage as Christians.
Amen.